So my story starts in 2001 when I was actually a business student in Vancouver, Canada. And studying business, I would love to procrastinate in the map room of the library at my university. And one day in the spring of 2001, I was looking at this gigantic wall map of Canada that was on the wall. And in the northernmost part of Canada, I found a fjord called Møkkafjord, or directly translated to English, Shitfjord. And surrounding this fjord with an enchanting name was a cluster of Norwegian place names. And I became so interested in finding out how these place names came to be that within a very short time span, I changed my major from business to history and then later polar history, a decision my mom has never forgiven me for. But after 6 years of studies, I discovered that these place names were the result of a long-forgotten second Norwegian Fram expedition that, through 4 years towards the end of the 19th century, mapped 150,000 square kilometers of unseen land. Having finished my master's thesis, I always, I thought I knew everything about the Arctic. But I figured out very quickly that all I knew was academic of nature. And from that day, my goal was to get up there and to walk in the footsteps of my great hero. And by 2008, I managed to get there. I've done a 60-day dog sled expedition in the furthest northern corner of the Canadian Arctic. But what I'd learned through that expedition in the years to follow was that the Arctic that I was traveling was radically different from the Arctic that the great explorers once traveled through. And the great change was, first of all, human-induced climate change. Our season was radically shorter than the one of Otto Sverdrup. The ice was thinner, and for us, the drastically reduced snow cover in the spring and summer months had a real impact. At the same time, we also realized that the historical movers in the Arctic was no longer the great explorers. It was now energy companies going north in order to realize the Arctic gold rush. So what I was faced with then, and what we are all faced with today, is what we call the Arctic paradox. And that is that the burning of fossil fuels makes it possible for us to go up there and drill for more of the stuff that makes the ice melt. And that's a paradox. Now, how do we get around that, or how do we solve this paradox? Well, as an environmentalist, it's quite easy. I think we should value the Arctic nature for its uniqueness, and we should protect it in a way so that it transcends generations. What we also should do is to use our talents to create a different energy future that leaves out the Arctic and reduce our CO2 emissions and go on a more sustainable road. But looking at this also as an historian, the landscape that I've traveled through, lying within the historic fabric of this landscape, I have concluded that the Arctic cannot and probably will not be part of our energy future. And in order to let you in on how I reached this conclusion, I'm going to take you to Canada's fabled Ellesmere Island, the northernmost island on the North American continent. Truly a very, very special place. Now, we landed there in the spring of last year, and for me as an historian, my motivation for going on these expeditions is to unravel a story. And as an historian, we try to unravel the past, try to make meaning of it, and perhaps we can make some meaning of history in the way that we approach the future. But I'm not sure that we as historians have ever succeeded in doing that, but I'm sure that we recognize patterns that are very useful for us today. Our goal was to identify a pile of rocks, or a cairn, after our walk. Well, first of all, we had to walk 1,000 kilometers to get there in order to find a pile of rocks, called a cairn, that was built by Sverdrup in the spring of 1902. Now, I know that might seem a little bit crazy, and it probably is, but I always felt as an historian, I could justify walking 1,000 kilometers to find a pile of rocks. Because for me, it was something tangible, it was something that I can touch, that was there when Otto Sverdrup discovered this enormous wilderness. But the question of why still remains. And we'll get to that, because as I learned, my opinion about the whole expedition changed. So after being walking for about 12 days, we reach a fjord called Trollfjord. Trolls, the Norwegian mountain monsters. And these trolls were guarding what Sverdrup described as Heaven's Gate. At the bottom of this fjord was the entry to Otto Sverdrup's Arctic paradise. So we walked this entire fjord, and at the bottom of it, we met exactly the same landscape that Sverdrup met. Deep, forbidding, steep mountainsides. It looked like there was no way through. But when we look carefully, we can find these narrow paths that would take us towards Heaven's Gate. And I'm not going to let you experience some of it.
Whoa, Axel. Whoa, boy.
And why this was called Heaven's Gate is because on the other side of this, we walk into an extraordinary microclimate that has the best conditions for wildlife. Prehistoric muskoxen were sort of scattered on every hilltop, and we also met an enormous number of these amazing polar hares. And next to the hares here is our Canadian rabbit whisperer, as he was called, my good friend Hugh. And as you can see, this is clearly not normal animal behavior. And because there's a lot of rabbits here, there's also an enormous amount of polar wolves, an incredible animal. And we had a lot of contact with these animals almost every day, and it seems that they were struggling to sort of figuring out what we were about and what we were doing there. On one occasion, one of the wolves actually stepped into our tent and stole one of our bags. Most of our bags were blue, and we also had all our film memory cards, the memory cards we took photos on, was in one of the blue bags. So thinking that the wolf might have stole our film, I took up the chase.
Fuck, he's right up to it.
He'll never get it.
No. Now, that's not only not normal animal behavior, but it's clearly not normal human behavior either. I never retrieved that bag, and it was full of bacon, if you ever wondered. But what these experiences did, I mean, by this time, we'd almost forgotten about the cairn. I mean, maybe what we discovered was something more important, because clearly we were in a land where we as human beings were truly visitors in the sense of the word itself. I mean, the animals show no sign of thinking of us as dangerous. We had not been part of their evolutionary process. And there's not many places on the planet left where you can experience just that. Like the old Captain Sverdrup put it, I venture to assert that it would be correct to consider these regions as the sole natural Arctic zoological gardens that has been left untouched by the destructive hand of man. Carrying on, the cairn was lingering in the distance. And on our day 44, we were getting close. All we had were sort of notes and diaries and Sverdrup's book. And we also had a photo of his northernmost camp from April or May 1902. So it was an enormous day for me when we got to his camp and we reconstructed it. And we used this as a starting point to look for this pile of rock. And the next day was even bigger, just where Sverdrup had said that he put it, the cairn was. Now, there was no note inside of there. There was no way to prove that this was Sverdrup's cairn. So we can never be sure that we were on the right place. But standing there, that didn't really matter. And standing there, I was thinking, you know, this is the only physical thing that remains of over a 100-year-old dream to make an Arctic empire for Norway, covering 150,000 square kilometers that Otto Sverdrup wanted to reap the riches of. And it also reminded me that the Arctic has always created heroes and villains. It has aspired to our imaginations, but it has always failed to be the next venue for human industrial development. If we think about it, in the 1930s, well, let's start before then, actually. For 300 years, some of the greatest empires on the planet tried to find the Northwest Passage that would make an easier transit route for ships to go from Europe to Asia. And they failed for 300 years, and yet we still don't have a workable Northwest Passage. In the 1930s, we thought that planes were going to go from Europe to the United States through the Arctic. So there was a network of frozen airlines built. And then, what happened? Well, technological development. We simply invented a plane that flew across the whole thing, so there was no need for this network of frozen airfields. Now, maybe if you think about it in this way, the Russian flag that was planted on the seabed underneath the North Pole a few years back, will that be similar to Otto Sverdrup's cairn in 100 years? Maybe. Now, it is true that when the Arctic has been hyped, and it has been regular in history done that, the next great for development of industrial enterprise, it has again and again been replaced by historical development or game changers in the south. In terms of energy, the Arctic is the last resort. But I'm convinced that we see now game changers already in place that might leave the Arctic obsolete again. Are we not seeing on the heightened focus on shale and oil gas in the south, or perhaps more importantly in the transition from a fossil economy to a renewable one, game changers that might come? And where is this going to leave the Arctic? By embracing change and focusing our talent, and there's a lot of it here tonight and in the audience that is watching this, we can actually make history repeat itself. And I'm actually, you know, we're told that history repeating itself is not a good thing, but I'm actually here to ask you to help history repeat itself so that the sole natural Arctic zoological gardens that as of yet has escaped the destructive hand of man can remain that way. Thank you.